Welcome to the Virtual Center for the Study of the Constitution and Civic Responsibility, an ongoing inquiry into the American political origins and evolving institutions. The Executive Director of the Virtual Center is Dr. Bill O'Brien. He's also your host for this continuing conversation. And here he is now, Dr. Bill O'Brien.
Agnes, thank you very, very much. Today is Wednesday. It is the 10th day of October in the year 2018, and the nation is bracing, of course, for the arrival of Hurricane Michael in not too long from now, early this afternoon, to hit the Florida coast with winds in excess of 140 miles an hour, which I'm chatting with Agnes before we came on, and I really don't believe many of the people that didn't heed the evacuation orders have never experienced anything this quite this powerful. And it's frightening. It is just absolutely frightening. And we were talking about the editorial in today's New York Times about the UN's warning on climate, and the fact that the time to debate it and procrastinate is over. Basically, what they're saying, if we don't act and act soon, we're not going to be able to do anything. We're not going to be able to act at all. And again, you get into the debates about the fact that changes have been happening in climate for as long as we've had it. But the fact of the matter is, I think you got to be blind to not know that you can affect, you don't cause it, but you affect it. You either make negative change worse, or you can make positive change better, or you can ameliorate negative change. And I think that's what we hands, and I think these storms and the severity of these storms, not only the frequency of them, but the severity of them. I'm thinking about the typhoon a couple of weeks ago in the Pacific. I mean, that was the strongest storm ever recorded. And they're in both oceans. And, you know, it's obvious that bad things are happening. And we got to look at what we might be doing to aid and abet those bad things and reverse course. And all the evidence in the world is falling on deaf ears, especially the ears of somebody who doesn't believe in evidence. So I don't know. It's a very frightening thing. I think all we can kind of do is keep the folks who are going to be bearing the brunt of this in our thoughts. Because I think cleanup on this one is going to be long, tough, and expensive. So welcome to today's program. Before we get into it, and before I give you the phone numbers and once again invite you to get on the air, come on the air with us and share your thoughts with us, I've got to say that as I'm thinking about today's program, depending on how far we get, I really believe that this might be one of the most important programs we've done. And I say that because I think I know where I'd like to go. And whether I can get there successfully or not is something else. But I do believe that this is extremely important. And what we're talking about is laying the groundwork for the Constitution of the United States. And that's really what this whole operation is about, the Virtual Center for the Study of the Constitution. It seems to me that how the Constitution fits into the historical setting in which it happens is significant. About 10 posted a document on Facebook, on our Facebook page. It's Madison's Vices of the American Political System. We've talked about it before. We've talked about certain portions of it before. But this is the first time that we'll be addressing and dealing with the substance, the content of that document in the context of setting the background, the stage for the Constitution of the United States. This morning in class, I was telling Agnes that I'm doing this, although not as much in as much detail, in class. And, you know, I can kind of read faces. And I'm getting the idea, you know, as I look around at students' faces. What I picked up today was almost as if a number of them were saying, I understand what you're saying, but nobody else is saying this. It can't be true. And the fact of the matter is, as far as I know, I believe it is. And it raises very, very important moral and ethical questions as to the way where we come down on some of these issues. I'm going to get into this. I think it toward the end of the hour, I can probably get into this a little bit. But the fact of the matter is, most of what we teach in our schools, in our education system, are blacks and whites. In other words, facts. And basically, our whole education system is oriented towards generating right answers and finding a way to discriminate, to separate the brightest students from the not as bright students. And the way we do it in our education system is by the generation of right answers. As you think about a process that goes on year after year after year, one thing we can all know for sure is that it doesn't take too long to see that the same students most of the time get the right answers, and the same students too often give the wrong answers. In other words, our system does indeed separate students into groups. And if the purpose of your education system is to educate everybody, then that's counterproductive. Because the only way that you can carry the weaker students to graduation, to a degree, is to lower the bar, lower the standards. Because all the data that you've been collecting over the years suggests that if you hold these people to the highest standards, they can't make it. They've demonstrated that year after year after year. And so if you stick to the high standards, what you are essentially doing is condemning the weaker students to failure, to continued failure. In a sense, then, you're really not educating people. You're separating people. And if that is the purpose, is to, as this was Thomas Jefferson, if you remember, about selecting the boy of best genius every year and dismissing the residue. Jefferson's whole idea of universal public education is to subject everybody to a competitive situation which gives you bright students from the not bright students. But the fact of the matter is we live in a world where everybody needs to be educated. Everybody needs to develop the kinds of skills so that they can become self-sustaining, so that they can become independent. But we're not doing that. And the fact of the matter is, and this is where we're going today, the fact of the matter is the most important issues in life, if our education system is going to really prepare people for life, and you look at life, it's very clear that the most important and challenging issues that we face are grays. They're not whites, and the blacks and whites are easy. Because the right answer is obvious. But what do you do when there really isn't a clear right answer or wrong answer. When it's a toss-up. When there's a way to justify going in one direction, but there's also a way to go in the other. A way to justify going in the other. And this gets down to this period that we've been dealing with in our programs. If you think about it, are these guys, these so-called nationalists, the ones that are trying every conceivable trick in the book to strengthen the central government, are they villains? Are they self-interested aristocrats who are only trying to create a government to benefit themselves? Or are they really statesmen in the truest sense of the world, of the word? I think all of us have to make a choice, make a decision. And so the reality is what we must do, it seems to me, is educate our young people to be able to make decisions in these tough, challenging areas. We've got to give people the skills so that they can begin to make the kinds of decisions that they're going to have to make in order to make it through life successfully. And if we keep focusing our school system on blacks and whites, on right answers and wrong answers, and separating the two groups on the assumption that only the ones that get the right answers all the time can be educated and everybody else can't be, then we're doing a tremendous disservice to our young people. We're doing a tremendous disservice to our nation. And I believe that. We're going to see this challenge, these ethical and moral challenges coming into play today with what we're going to be doing with the Confederation period and the Constitution to follow. The document, as I mentioned, that I put on Facebook about 10 minutes before we came on the air was Madison's Vices of the American Political System. A couple of things about it are important. I'm going to basically mention those now, and then I'm going to give the phone numbers and my email address and those kinds of things. And it would give those of you who are interested time to go on our website and look at this document, because we're going to be probably but not until our second hour, but we're going to be looking much more carefully at this document. And here are the couple of things I wanted to say, and then we'll wait and pick it up later. The publication date, the date that Madison made public this document, The Vices of the American Political System, first of all, he didn't make it public. Let me clarify that. He sent copies of it to his closest allies and friends. But it was done in April of 1787. The Constitutional Convention was scheduled to meet in May. May 14th, actually. But the reality is that they don't get enough people. They don't get a quorum at the Constitutional Convention. They're not ready to go and do business until the last week of May, towards the 25th, 26th of May. And so what they're doing is cooling their heels and waiting for enough people to get there so they can begin. But the fact of the matter is that the convention is scheduled to begin in May. Madison sends this document out to his closest allies in April. And basically what he's saying to them is it's less than a month before this convention meets. Here's the agenda. Here's the issue. Here's why we're there. Here's what's wrong with the government in this country. Here's the reason why this country can't make it unless we make some very serious changes. So basically what he's doing is laying the groundwork for the Constitution of the United States, which effectively he writes, because he is the author of the Virginia Plan, which is the plan handed out at the beginning of the convention, and it's debate about that plan that fills the entire convention through the summer. So basically, Madison's Virginia plan becomes the basic formula, the basic outline of the Constitution. So why is this particular document, the Vices document, important? Because Madison is laying out the problems that need to be addressed, and then he's distributing the Virginia plan, which is his solution as to how best to address them. And with amendments, because the convention goes all the way from May until September, a lot of amendments are necessary. A lot of changes are necessary. But the bottom line is, with amendments, the Virginia plan is the Constitution. It's the solution to these problems. How in heaven's name can we teach young people about the Constitution without them being at all familiar with what the problems were that led to it? And the same guy puts together both. He outlines the problems and then he lays out the solutions. I believe that this is potentially the most important program that we will do on this, at the Virtual Center, on this program. I really do believe. So before we get started, I want to give you the phone numbers and invite you to participate. You might say, now after that introduction, you think I'm going to call? And what I'm saying is, look, we're going to be back Monday. We can pick this up Monday. We can repeat it Monday. We can review it. Don't worry about it. The most important thing is if you've got something to say or something to contribute that will benefit not just me, but our other listeners, which is really the most important thing because that's what this program is about, are hopefully the people who can begin to get something out of it. If you've got something to contribute, believe me, they need to hear it. I need to hear it. And so you are welcome to call at any time, no matter where we are on an issue or whatever. We can always postpone and pick it back up later. But the point is, if you have something to say, something to contribute, a meaningful comment, question, suggestion, whatever it might be, and you let this opportunity pass, it's gone forever. What I was going to cover is not gone. I can cover it the next time. So therefore, your comments, your contributions are really the most important part of what we're about, not mine. Because thanks to Bob and Agnes and the Head On Radio Network, I've got the time to address what I want to address. You don't. And our listeners who are going without your comment, your suggestion, your question, proposal, whatever it might be, they'll never get it without you either. So this is a tremendous opportunity, it seems to me, for an exchange of points of view and opinions and interpretations and various other things. We've got two phone numbers that'll get you directly into the studios, and Agnes will get you on the air immediately. The first number, both of them are the same area code, 304. The first one is area code 304-574-8178. That's 304-574-8178. The second number, which is rather recent, is same area code, 304-640-2829. 640-2829. If you'd like to get your thoughts or ideas to me and trust me to get them on the air for you, I'd be honored to do it. My email address is waobrien906@gmail.com. That's waobrien, O-B-R-I-E-N, 906, all one word, lowercase, @gmail.com. Or you can go directly to our Facebook page. And you're going to be on our Facebook page anyway if you go look at this document on the vices, because I just put it on there. It's the first posting you'll come to. To get on our Facebook page, just go to Facebook, facebook.com, and that'll take you to the homepage. And there's a search box at the top. And if you type in the Virtual Center for Study of the Constitution, you'll be into our Facebook page. And after every posting, including this one, there are two links. One is a share link. The other one is a comment link. The share link gives you the opportunity to share that posting with your friends, with the other, your other friends on Facebook. In other words, it widens our audience. It helps all of us. The comment button, if you click on that, gives you the opportunity to come back immediately to me. And your comment can be obviously related to that particular posting, but it doesn't have to be. You can make comments, things that you would like to say if you were on the air, but for one reason or another, you're not comfortable or are reluctant to come on the air. Then you can comment that way. Because when our program is over and I go back online and take a look at our Facebook page, if you make a comment to one of the postings there, I'm going to be notified of that immediately. So the first thing I'll do when I see it is go to that particular posting in order to look at your comment. And depending on what it is, if it appears to be something that our other listeners would benefit from and need to know, then I'll do the very best I can to get it on the air for you the next time we're back together, first of next week. So that's really the issue. And what I'd what I'd like to do is to go back and just raise a couple of questions about what we've done so far for purposes of review. In other words, it gets our mind back into this period. And I think, you know, I've been teaching long enough to know that when you have a couple of days or sometimes a full week, if you have a 3-hour class that meets one time a week, then obviously people forget what we were even doing a week earlier. So you have to spend a portion of the program at the start kind of reviewing or touching the bases again that you touched last time in order to get people's focus and people's mind back into the subject at hand, and then you can go on. Well, we don't have that problem, really, in the sense that we meet 3 consecutive days. So if you were with us Monday and Tuesday this week, then you may not need the review. But for those people that are with us but weren't with us yesterday, for example, they do, because they're not going to be able to follow the rest of the program today unless they understand what happened up until today, where we're coming from. So that's why I wanted to take a couple of minutes to approach or to deal with what we already dealt with. And let me do it in this way. I'd like to raise a couple of questions about the Confederation period, or a couple of ways of looking at the Confederation period. The first one is a book by historian John Fiske, F-I-S-K-E. The title of the book is The Critical Period in American History. And the book was published in 1888. And what John Fiske does is write what realistically becomes almost the definitive history of the Confederation period. But he does it from a very particular point of view, a very specific point of view. He looks at the Confederation period as the nation's most critical period ever in its history. Because his basic premise is that even though the nation was successful in winning its independence, if it continued to try to function under the existing government, under the Articles of Confederation, The nation was doomed to failure. We never would have made it. We never would have survived. In other words, it's literally the life of this nation that was on the line during the Confederation period. And if something wasn't changed, something wasn't fixed, Fisk believed we wouldn't have made it. It wouldn't have made it. So to him, the Constitution of the United States is the nation. It literally saved a nation in danger of dying and gave it the foundation or the basis it needed in order to go forward and prosper. That's the overall thesis of John Fisk. And without going into a lot of detail on John Fisk himself, let me point out that John Fisk wrote this in 1888. Now, what we're saying is this is 25, 30 years after Darwin's book on evolution, Origin of the Species. And Fisk is a product of Darwin, of the Darwin period. There's no question that if you read the book, and you read his other book, he's written a number of other books. He is an evolutionist. ...100% in the things that Darwin is saying in his Origin of the Species. He believes that an ongoing, endless evolution process is always underway. And he believes that, in other words, life is a process of constant change. And the second thing he believes, which is kind of straight Darwin and evolution, is that change, this change, is ultimately positive. It may appear negative for a time, but long term, it's positive. Because what Darwin does is look at nature, do the kind of research which shows the way that different species of life evolve from generation to generation, and according to Darwin, become stronger and stronger and stronger. In other words, Darwin believes that evolution, the process of constant change in nature, is a positive process. It's moving us further and further along towards progress. And so if he puts that philosophy into his writing on the Confederation period and establishes the degree to which the Confederation period is the nation's most critical period, then what he's doing is laying the groundwork for the positive changes to come, which to him is the Constitution of the United States. And that becomes the dominant thesis of the Confederation period. Every textbook, every American history textbook that you pick up, I don't care whether it's grade school, high school, college, every textbook will have a chapter on the Confederation period. And basically, the approach will be John Fisk's approach. In other words, the survival of the nation was at risk until the Constitution of the United States was drafted and ratified, and thereby saved the nation. What I'm trying to suggest here is that John Fisk's book, The Critical Period, is a thesis. It's a way of looking at the Confederation period. And what it means is he's going to emphasize the problems, the challenges of the Confederation period, and is going to emphasize the inability of government to address them, to solve them. He's going to point out that the nation experiences many challenges after independence is won with the peace treaty in 1783. But it's trying to address these challenges with a national government that has no power, because power is in the states. And the only way that this could work would be if all the states work together and all the states respond positively to the needs and wants of the national government. Because Congress, which is the national government under the Articles of Confederation, Congress is assigned certain responsibilities to conduct foreign policy, to deal in relations with the Indians, to do everything it can do. But because the states were so afraid that a government on the national level that was too strong would infringe on the rights of the states, the Articles of Confederation specifically denied the central government, Congress, certain key powers. Congress, the government, national government, could not tax. It could not regulate commerce. It could not regulate trade, either among the states, between the states, or between the states and foreign nations. Trade was totally under the control of the states. And finally, raising an army. Congress did not have the power to raise an army. And of course, the thinking is, if you deny it the power to raise an army, then the only way that the government could defend itself, protect itself, is if the national government requested military help from the states. So ultimately, this decision would be a state decision, not a congressional decision. So what you've done is effectively deny the central government all the resources it would need to become independent of state control. And thereby, you've rendered it totally dependent on the states. Consequently, when many of the challenges come and hit the nation, Congress is unable to address them because it doesn't have the power. All it can do is make requests to the states. But if the states choose not to respond, then Congress is helpless. Its hands are tied. So if you look at the Confederation period, you see a number of problems. The first one, and the most obvious one, is recession. We know, think about it, that a nation undergoes recession after every war. It stands to reason. Because in order to prosecute a war, everybody has to be contributing. Everybody has to be working. There are jobs. Because the nation is on a war footing, and everybody has something to contribute, everybody has to pitch in. So by definition, when you're in a state of war or preparing for a state of war, you don't have to worry about recession, about low or slow economies, about layoffs or unemployment. Chances are there's going to be such a need for employment that you're going to be short of labor. During World War II, for example, women had to move into the factories and man the machines because the men were off fighting war. In other words, you need everybody. But obviously, when the war ends, you don't need this mass production anymore. The economy slows down. Jobs disappear. Layoffs happen. And when you lose your job, you lose your income. And when you lose your income, you can't buy things. And if you can't buy things, then the people who make those things suffer also. And so that's the way the Depression gets deeper and deeper and deeper. And it happens after every war. In this particular case, after independence is won, the recession is particularly severe Because when the colonies win their independence and become free and independent states from the mother country, they lose access to the empire. They lose all the trade contacts that they had as colonies. And so they lose their markets. And they can't sell what they produce. So the fact of the matter is, people are in trouble economically through the 1780s. It's a deep recession, 1785 and 86 especially, are severe downturns in the economy. Also, they lose the benefits of British protection, military protection. They become vulnerable to threatening nations. They become vulnerable to Indians in the West. And so there are a lot of threats, military and economic, that the nation faces. Congress doesn't have the power to do anything with any of them. So Fisk is right. There's a problem. All right, let's look more deeply at the situation, at the political situation. If Congress doesn't have the power to deal with them, the states do. So what's going on in the states during this period? To what extent are the states willing to come to the aid of their citizens who are hurting? Well, traditionally, that doesn't happen. Traditionally, government supports the few, the wealthy, the property, business, the creditor groups. In other words, if you're owed money and the person who owes it to you refuses to pay, then you have government on your side. You can take this person, this debtor, who won't pay to court. They can go to jail for non-payment of debts, or they can go to jail for non-payment of taxes, or their property can be confiscated by the banks and resold for a song. So, as bad as the recession is, it makes a lot of real estate opportunities available to the people with the most money. In spite of the fact that people are hurting, some people are not. They are the creditors. And these people who are hurting the most are always the ones who suffer during recessions and/or depressions. So, for example, if you look at the 1920s, prior to the Great Depression in this country, the economy was flying. The stock market was booming. Yet what becomes the Great Depression was already hitting a lot of working people. Unemployment was rampant. Labor strikes were frequent. The difference is that employers, companies, could call on government to crush labor strikes, to crush violence, to force people to pay their debts. And so the fact of the matter is, even in the worst of times, government supports the system rather than the people in it. Herbert Hoover believed that the free enterprise system was strong, that the free enterprise system worked. And he believed government's job was to do whatever was necessary to beef up, strengthen the free enterprise system. Because if the system functioned, if the institutions continued to work, then eventually the system itself would pull us out of the depression. The problem was, this time, the depression was much deeper than it had ever been before. You had 25% unemployment, for example. Farmers were burning their crops rather than bringing them to market because prices were so low. So what Hoover does, and of course, interestingly enough, what Roosevelt does when he first comes in, the first thing they both do is beef up the banks. Because the argument is people rely on the banks because that's where their money is. So what you got to do is make sure that the banks are strong and the banks are protected. What did Obama do in 08? Basically, the government bailed out banks and investment firms and insurance companies. It's the system that constantly gets government's attention first. The people who need handouts, food lines, soup kitchens, and all the rest of it, that comes later. The assumption is if you make that your priority, the system will never pull us out. So that's the belief. What was different about the Confederation period? The Confederation period was the only time in American history up until then, and I would say the only time since then, that government began to come to the aid of people first. Why? Because the structure of the Articles of Confederation made it possible. Because people's commitment to the idea of Republican government during and after the Revolution meant that they wrote state constitutions that put power in the hands of the branch of government closest to the people, the legislative branch. What the Articles did was create a weak central government. Then the Articles encouraged states to write their own constitutions. And those constitutions, while they were different, obviously each one was different because it applied to a different state, but they had certain things in common. These people communicated with each other. They would send letters back and forth from state to state. Hey, this is what we're doing in our state. What are you guys doing? And that went on all the time with the writing of state constitutions. So when you begin to compare them, you begin to see key similarities. One of the similarities is they all have weak executives. They all have weak governors. The second thing is they tend to have strong legislatures. Most of the power is put in the people's branch of government. There's no judicial branch such as exists today. There are courts. But these courts are appointed and report to legislatures. And the governments are weak, so the governors are weak, so they don't have veto power or anything like that. What legislatures pass becomes. In other words, when the legislature passes it, governors can't veto it, courts can't rule it unconstitutional, it becomes the law. And then the next thing that these constitutions have in common is frequent elections, annual elections. These elected members of state legislatures are reelected every year, which means that if your government doesn't do what you want it to do, you can kick them out of office quickly and replace them with somebody else. The result of all of this, all these common features, is that the Articles of Confederation becomes the most democratic time in American history ever. The Confederation period is the only period when most governments, most state governments, put the priorities of people first rather than the priorities of the few. priorities of the wealthy, priorities of the propertied, priorities of the investment and financial class. These governments respond to the plight of their citizens because for the first time and only time in history, the people have direct access to lawmaking, to government. They can control the legislatures, and nobody has the power to control what comes out of the legislatures. Which means when citizens come to a legislature and say, if you want to get elected, you will pass this and this and this, and you will not enforce those things. And if you do, you're out of office. So for the first time in the nation's history, government is putting the public interest first. But again, these are state governments, not the national government. The national government doesn't have the power to do the most important things. So many states begin to pass legislation to benefit citizens during these tough economic times. Governments begin to pass paper money. Seven states passed paper money legislation during the Confederation period. In other words, they print money. There's no philosophy, no deep theory about this. People naturally conclude, if we don't have enough money to pay our debts or pay our taxes, then you just go to government and say, print more. And they don't understand that when you print more, the value of it becomes less and less and less. That money becomes worthless. So what you begin to see is these states begin to crank out paper money. They make money much more available to people. Not only that, but since they pass laws to issue the paper money, that paper money is legal tender. And what that means is creditors must accept it. So imagine yourself to be Walmart or MasterCard. Comes time for somebody's monthly payment to come in, and they come in with paper money that's still wet because it was just printed. Obviously, the MasterCard officials are going to say, we're not taking that. That paper is worthless. But you can say, you have to take it. This is state printed money. It's legal tender. You have to take it. So government is passing laws, forcing creditors to take payments that they didn't agree to take. Many states pass installment laws. Installment laws give people the right to make payments rather than pay off the entire balance of what they owe. In other words, if I lend you $1,000 and I say to you, no, you got to pay me back in 6 months. 6 months comes and you don't have it. Then I foreclose. I call government, call my government or the courts or whatever, and I say, arrest him. He owes me $1,000 and he won't pay me. So what happens this time? Legislatures pass installment laws. And what they say is, because the times are tough and people have difficulty getting their hands on cash, therefore, we, the government of whatever state it is, give our citizens the authority to make time payments in order to make repayment of their obligations more likely. So I'm MasterCard, and suddenly somebody's coming in and giving me 2%, 1% of what they owe me, because the legislature's passed the law giving them the right to do that. I go crazy if I'm MasterCard or Sears Roebuck or Walmart or whatever. Or if it's a private loan. On my right to write a contract with you privately. You and I enter into a contract. I loan you X amount of money. You guarantee me to pay me back by such and such a time. If you don't, you're in default. Government can arrest you. Because government is paying installments. Some states even pass what are called stay laws, STAY. And what they do is suspend debt and tax payments for a period of time. In other words, times are tough. People don't have the money. So therefore, what we're going to do is give people the authority to skip their payments for the next 3 months. MasterCard and the banks would immediately say, if we don't get the money that's owed us, we're out of business. Because it's people paying us money that gives us the capital to loan money to other people. And if the payments stop coming in, we don't have it to loan. We're out of business. Also, many states close courts, stop foreclosing on people's mortgages because too many people are being displaced. In other words, this is the first time in the history of the country and the last time that government's principal priority are its citizens rather than its businesses, rather than its investors, rather than the wealthy. That's why many people, and I'm one, will label the Confederation period the most democratic period this nation has ever had. But let me bring all of this together. Because this is the most democratic period the nation ever had, to the wealthy class, to the bankers and the investors and the large landowners and the land speculators and the merchants. This period is, as John Fiske tells us, this period is critical because it's the most democratic government this nation ever had. In other words, I would argue that it's not opposites. You can't have the same stuff be meaning two different things. It's either a critical period or it's the period where government begins to address the needs of its people like no time in history before or since. So it's either that or the period is critical. But the fact of the matter is, depending on who you are, it's both. To the creditors, it's critical. To citizens, it's what democracy is all about. The fact of the matter is, this is the reason that some thinking, prominent, well-educated nationalists like James Madison and Alexander Hamilton and James Wilson and Benjamin Franklin and George Washington and John Adams and some of the most promising leaders in their states begin to try to figure out a way to resolve this problem. Nationalists believe that you can't run a country this way, that we are going to go down the tubes, that the country can't survive this way. You got to find a way to establish the rule of law and make everybody obey. And in order to do that, you got to have government that has the power to do it. So major political changes are necessary. And the most obvious one is to strengthen the central government. So throughout the 1780s, You see very subtle creative efforts to strengthen the central government. We talked about a couple of them yesterday. Impost bills, tariffs, Congress requests, leaders request that Congress be given the power to tax imports. And that money go directly to Congress so that our government can pay the foreign creditors we owe, the people who lend us money to fight the revolution. But what they are really after is finding a way to make government not dependent on the states anymore. And the impost of 81 passes, except Rhode Island refuses to approve it. And the Articles of Confederation says that any changes to the Articles, any amendment, requires the unanimous vote of all the states. All the states have to agree, or you can't change the Articles. So, again, in 1783, they try another impost. It fails again. In Pennsylvania, they create a state bank, the Bank of Philadelphia. But many of the nationalists begin to see if we can spread that bank and have it serve other states as well, it effectively becomes a national bank. And they begin to call it the Bank of North America. And what it would do would create a financial institution to make loans to new businesses and all the rest of it. In other words, the argument is that economic development, economic growth requires that the central government have some sort of control over the currency, over the finances of the nation, in order to create stability, encourage people to invest in the future. The Bank of North America is defeated. In 1785, Virginia and Maryland are meeting on trying to figure out how to divide the tariffs, the commerce on the Potomac River, which divides the two states. They decide in March of 85 to have a formal meeting between the two states. George Washington invites them to bring the delegates from these two states to Mount Vernon. Those textbooks which deal with it refer to this as the Mount Vernon Conference. And once they get together, they begin to say, hey, this may be what we're looking for. Every state must conduct trade. Every state has trade issues. Why don't we schedule a convention and get all the states together to discuss commerce? The Annapolis Convention for September of 1786. And the Mount Vernon Conference puts out an invitation to representatives of all the states to come to Annapolis in the fall, in September of 86. To try to regulate the nation's commerce. But when Annapolis comes, only five states show up. Why? Why do only five states show up? Because many of them realize that this is no more about commerce than the man on the moon. This is about strengthening the central government at the expense of the states. And most states won't go for it. So when the convention meets, only five states show up. Annapolis looks to be a failure. But one of the states that does attend is New York. And Alexander Hamilton, according to our textbooks, snatches victory from likely defeat by putting out a call for another convention the next spring, May of 1787 in Philadelphia, to address the exigencies of the Union and revise the Articles of Confederation. In other words, Hamilton is saying in this call that comes out of Annapolis, there's no sense trying to cover it up by calling it commerce anymore. Everybody realizes what it is, so let's lay our cards on the table. This is a conference to consider revision of the Articles of Confederation. As we were talking about yesterday, four states don't even elect delegates to Annapolis. So obviously they're not there because they don't want any part of it. Because they know it's a meeting about commerce, which is really a cover for a meeting whose purpose is to take power away from the state governments, and they won't touch it. So they don't even, four states don't even elect delegates. Five do. They show up. Another four do. So in other words, 9 of the 13 elect delegates to Annapolis. But only 5 show up there. The delegates from four states never make it until after the convention's over. Otto, in his communique to Vergennes in France, tells us that these delegates from these four states, 3 of them New England states and the other one North Carolina, are delayed in New York. This is a conference that was scheduled for 18 months. And they show up late? Four states? It kind of suggests that something is not right here. And what's not right, it turns out, is that the nationalists, Hamilton and Madison being the two major ones at Annapolis, are afraid that if Annapolis works, if all the states send delegates and they really do reach an agreement about how to regulate commerce, then there's no chance left of strengthening the central government or revising the articles. So their real purpose is not commerce, it's revising the articles. So even though they put out the call for a commercial convention, if it was successful, then revision of the articles would become impossible. So they make damn sure that delegates from four states never even get there. And then Hamilton puts out the call for the Philadelphia convention. There's no question it's deceitful. It's duplicitous. Otto says to Vergennes that the way they write this report is devious, it's deceitful, it's full of circumlocutions and ambiguities so that the general masses of the people won't have any idea what's going on. But the leaders will. They know exactly what's going on. So in 1787, May, the Constitutional Convention opens in late May, and the opening address is given by Governor Randolph of Virginia. And he says basically in his opening address, "Gentlemen, we are here because there's too much democracy in this country, and we're here to see if we can fix that." And then he says, "Revise the articles, which is the reason many of you came here. We believe that the articles are so weak and need so much change that the best thing we can do is scrap them and start all over again." And then he distributes copies of Madison's Virginia Plan, which becomes, with amendments, the Constitution of the United States. This was a well-laid strategy of the nationalists to strengthen the central government. So the question that remains is if only five states showed up at Annapolis, why did 12 show up in Philadelphia? And the answer is Shays' Rebellion in late September, October in Massachusetts. Open rebellion breaks out in Western Massachusetts. The farmers storm the armory and arm themselves with militia weapons and begin to close down courts and stop foreclosing on private property. In other words, the civil war that everybody was worried about happens in Western Massachusetts. The state militia puts it down. But if you read the newspapers in the other states, you'd swear that the end of the world, Armageddon itself, was happening in Western Massachusetts. All this talk about the citizens of Western Massachusetts have armed themselves. They're in open rebellion. They're raping women and children. They scare the hell out of people throughout the country. So that when the Philadelphia Convention meets in May, with the only exception being Rhode Island, all the states are there. Because they quickly realize that all of us face the same kinds of situation that Massachusetts faced. George Washington puts out this panicky letter to friends and says, "My God, what's happening in Massachusetts? If the people who owe me money didn't pay me, I'd be gone. I'd be out of business." So the fact of the matter is, it's against this background that the Constitution of the United States is drafted. We've gone 5 minutes over, and I apologize. I hope that we could get done by the top of the hour. We almost made it, but we didn't quite make it. So let's pause and take a 4 or 5 minute break, and then we'll come back and we'll look at Madison's solutions. First of all, we'll look at Madison's explanation of the problems, and then we'll look for the solutions. You're listening to the Virtual Center for Study of the Constitution and Civic Responsibility. We're going to pause for a 4 or 5 minute break, then we'll be right back with our second hour. Please stay with us. Thank you.
now return to the Virtual Center for the Study of the Constitution and Civic Responsibility. Here's your host, Dr. Bill O'Brien.
Well, thank you, Agnes, and welcome to our second hour. It's abbreviated, obviously. We're 12 minutes after the hour, so we've got a little bit better than 45 minutes of program time left. But I think it's time enough to do what I'd like to do. I put up, as I mentioned earlier, for those that have been with us through the first hour, I put a posting on Facebook about 10 minutes before we came on the air today, which is Madison's Vices of the Political System of the United States. It's the document that he sent to his allies and colleagues a month before the Constitutional Convention opened. And it pretty well summarizes much of the story that constitutes what we did during the first hour and what we did at the end of the program yesterday. I will tell you that I did not put the entire document, but only excerpts from it, on the Facebook page, because the document completed it prints out to 5 pages, and you can't put anything that long on Facebook. So I tried to cut it down as much as I could. I cut it down to about 1.75 pages, and I put that on there, but it's a pretty long document. So what I'd like to do this hour is touch the highlights, with the idea that since the document is on our Facebook page, you can go back and fill in the details at your leisure. Because my goal is to try to get through this today so that I don't leave, 5 days before we have an opportunity to pick it up again. But I think maybe the beginning of next week's programs on Monday, we can kind of begin to talk about this in a general sense and what the significance of it is, because I do believe it's incredibly important. Madison lays out in his Vices of the Political System of the United States 12 specific problems that only revision of the Articles of Confederation can fix. I've excerpted probably 5 or 6 of those 12. Not only that, but I edited down the language in several of them to make them shorter. But I tried to leave what I thought was the essence. So again, you have to realize that this is not all the document, the entire document. And so I leave myself open to the charge that maybe what he did was go through the document and pull out only those parts which backed up what he wants us to believe. I've basically already covered what I think the story is. And what I'm trying to do is use this document to point out where I got it. Because what Madison does is summarize it all. And what that means is, for evidence to back up the validity of what I've said in our first hour, I've got this document by James Madison to prove it. I think this is it. And so with that, I'd like to touch on a few of these things with you here in our second hour. The first point that Madison makes, the first challenge or weakness of the Articles of Confederation, he calls failure of the states to comply with the constitutional requisitions. Translation: Congress was put into the position of having to request from the states what it needed to function. And what Madison is saying in this first point is, too often the states refuse to comply with those requests. In other words, we created a government that's totally dependent on the states. But even then, the states refuse to respond to legitimate requests from Congress. So therefore, they're making it impossible for Congress to do even the exercise the powers that it was given under the Articles. Madison said that from the number and the independent authority of the states, this has been a problem of every confederacy in the history of man that's created like this one. Namely, the inability of the members of the confederacy to fulfill their obligations have proven in the past and are now proving, quote, fatal to the object of the present system, unquote. So the first problem is that the states have to live up to their obligations and they're not. Number two, encroachment by the states on the federal authority. The states are actually interfering with the powers that we have, that Congress has. In other words, even the few powers that we got, the states are interfering with those. He gives examples. For example, Georgia is writing separate treaties with the Indians in order to get control of their lands. Under the Constitution, under the Articles, it's Congress that's given the responsibility for dealing with Native American tribes, with Indian tribes. And that means that if Congress has the power to do it, the states shouldn't do it. But they are, and he uses Georgia as an example. He also points to the 1785 meeting between Virginia and Maryland on commerce along the Potomac. And his point is, this Constitution, such as it is, does not allow individual states to make separate agreements amongst themselves. So, in effect, the states of Virginia and Maryland are encroaching on federal authority. And then he points to the troops raised and to be kept up in Massachusetts, which is obviously the army that's raised to put down Shays' Rebellion. And he says what this makes very clear is that the government doesn't even have the authority that the Articles give it, because the states are taking it upon themselves to do what they want to do. And then I've skipped to number four. And that is the fact that the states are trespassing on the rights of each other. This whole system assumes that the states will cooperate to support Congress in the powers that the Articles of Confederation give that Congress. But instead of that, the states are not cooperating with each other. They're competing with each other. They're trying to take advantage of each other. They're trying to one-up each other. And here are the examples he uses. Paper money, installments of debts, occlusion of courts, in other words, closing the courts, making property a legal tender, that's another one, is the states pass laws giving people the right to use property to pay their obligations, pay their debts and taxes. For example, cows, cattle, head, livestock. You basically force your creditor to take a couple of head of cattle in place of the money you owe. And if the state passes a law saying that your creditor has to accept that, then the government has interfered with a private contract between you and me. What Madison says is paper money, installment of debts, closing of courts, making property legal tender. All of these things. Because people borrow money from banks housed in other states. And if a bank located in Virginia loans me money and I refuse to make the payments, And the state that I'm in doesn't force me to pay the state of Virginia, then I'm using my state against Virginia in order to avoid my debts. And what point four says, Madison says, as the citizens of every state aggregately taken stand more or less in creation of in relation of creditors or debtors to the citizens of every other state. Acts of the debtor state in favor of debtors affect the creditor state in the same manner as they do its own citizens who are relative creditors toward other citizens in their own state. And this thing can apply to foreign nations as well. In other words, if people, debtors, use their ability to get control of government to infringe on their obligations to pay off debts and taxes, then in effect, Madison is saying, you can't run a country that way. In other words, what Madison is saying is this is really a critical problem. Of course, the fact of the matter is John Fisk doesn't write his book Critical Period until 1888, which is more than 100 years later. But he's looking back at this stuff and he's saying, no wonder the period, the nation almost went under in the Confederation period. So again, creditors are not being paid because debtors are using their ability to get control of state legislatures to pass laws making it legal for them not to pay, not to fulfill their responsibilities. Madison's sixth item, guarantee to the states to protect their constitutions and laws against internal violence. In other words, Congress has been denied the authority it needs to ensure domestic violence in the state, to prevent domestic violence in the states. Congress didn't have any power to go into Massachusetts and crush Shay's rebellion. The state of Massachusetts had to do it. But what if the state of Massachusetts couldn't do it? Who would do it? What if Shay's rebellions broke out in every state? Because every state has foreclosures of farms and property and bankruptcies and all the rest of it. These are tough times. This is a recession. What if Shay's rebellions break out in all the states? What are we going to do? Madison is saying. And then he talks about Republican theory. And Republican theory means that right and power go hand in hand. And basically what he's talking about is when it happens that the majority, and the debtors are always the majority, if the system of government, the state constitution, makes legislatures vulnerable to majorities, and if the majority at issue in question is debtors linking up to take control of government and force legislatures to pass state laws and paper money laws and all the rest of it, then in effect, majority rule is the problem. Democracy is not the solution to our problems. Democracy is our problem. Madison says, under the six, one-third of those who participate in the choice of the rulers can be rendered a majority by the accession of those whose poverty excludes them from a right of suffrage and who, for obvious reasons, will be more likely to join the standard of sedition than that of the established government. We've got all these poor people around. So if a wealthy, influential person who owes money a debtor who's prominent, a demagogue, then it puts him in a position to appeal to the other debtors and whip them up into a frenzy. In other words, create a mob. How much are we hearing now about President Trump saying that the protesters against Kavanaugh that were filling the halls of Congress, the Senate, and trying to disrupt the hearings, the confirmation hearings of Brett Kavanaugh, and were marching in the street with signs. Mitch McConnell called them a mob. Donald Trump called them a mob. Donald Trump said last night in his address in Iowa at one of his rallies, to elect the Democrats is to give power to an unruly mob. He said, if you saw the video, we don't give matches to an arsonist. You don't give power to a mob. That's, in effect, what Madison is saying here under 6. When government is so susceptible to majority rule that it becomes accessible, something's broken, badly broken. Number 7, Madison talks about a want of sanction to the laws and of coercion in the government of this Confederacy. We don't have the power, Congress doesn't have the power to enforce its laws. Government doesn't have the power to force people to obey government. So if Shay's rebellions start to break out in state after state after state, we don't have the power to do anything. What if the states can't put it down by themselves? What do we do? And then he says, the Articles of Confederation were never ratified by all the people. Therefore, they don't constitute a real constitution, fundamental law, because the only people that can create fundamental law and write constitutions are the people acting as a unit in unity. Since this government was created by the states, not by the people of the United States, it's not a constitution. It's not legitimate. Its laws can't be fundamentally, can't conform to fundamental law. Madison says at the end of this particular item, number 8, that if a state, one state, violates or breaches any of the Articles of Confederation, it tends to absolve the other parties, the other states, from their own obligations and give them a right, if they choose to exert it, of dissolving the Union altogether. In other words, if the state has the power, if the states have all the power, then one state can refuse to obey or refuse to fulfill its responsibilities. And if one state gets away with it, the other states are going to do the same thing. And when all the states decide to go their own way and not honor the rules of the Confederation, then the Union itself is dissolved. I would point out to you that's pretty much what happened at the time of our Civil War. The Southern states began to argue that they had the freedom to secede from the Union, based on this assumption that we were a confederation of states. But under the Constitution, we're not a federation of states. It's a government created by the people of the United States. Therefore, when one state chooses to not obey, that state is in rebellion. And that was Lincoln's position in prosecuting the Civil War. And then the last point that I want to deal with is number 11. Number 12, the very last one, he talks about the impotence of the laws of the state. In other words, half the times they're not being enforced anyway because the people don't want them to be enforced. But number 11 is the biggest one. And what he's talking about is the injustice of the state laws. The fact that in order for justice to be achieved, the laws have to be uniform. You can't have each state making its own individual laws. You can't have a country where you have 13 different constitutions and 13 different sets of laws. There are so many, and they're so easy to change, that there's no way in the world that people can be held responsible for obeying the law because it changes all the time. Madison says under this, there are two problems with the situation we're in. One is the problem of the representatives themselves. The other is a problem among the people themselves. And this is what Madison says. When you have so many different laws and they change so easily, you violate the fundamental principle of republican government, that the majority who rule these governments are the safest guardians of the public good and private rights. Once government becomes susceptible to majorities, then justice becomes impossible. The only way that you can guarantee the rule of law and justice, guarantee that everybody will be treated the same, is if the people do not have the right or the power to get control of government. The danger we face, Madison says, is that it is majorities that are ruling these state governments. And therefore, the principles of republican government that majorities need to rule are being violated. You can't have majority rule and at the same time expect the rule of law and justice to be a reality. And then he goes into, there are two causes of this, or two sources of that problem. The representatives themselves and the people who elect them. And Madison said, as far as the representatives themselves, representatives run for public office for three motives, Madison says. Three reasons. Ambition, personal interest, and the public good. In other words, what brings people into government service, into public service, is either ambition, self-interest, or a desire to do good for their fellow man, public service. Madison says, unfortunately, unhappily, the first two are proved by experience to be the most prevalent. Public good, public service is not what brings most of these people into government. It's personal ambition, self-interest. They go after a piece of the pie they can do good for themselves. He said, candidates who feel the ambition of public interest, he said, especially the second, self-interest, are the most industrious and the most successful in pursuing their object and forming often a majority in the legislative councils with self-interested views contrary to the interest, the views of their constituents. Basically, people are in office for the wrong reason too often. But then Madison goes on to the second one and said, the reason for this being a problem are the people themselves. The reason this one is so important is because this becomes the model for what becomes Federalist Number 10 in the Federalist Papers. Once you read this, you'll understand Federalist 10. Here's what it says. A still more fatal, if not more frequent, cause lies among the people themselves. All civilized societies are divided into different interests and factions, as they happen to be creditors or debtors, rich or poor, husbandmen, farmers, merchants or manufacturers, members of different religious sects, followers of different political leaders, inhabitants of different districts, owners of different kinds of property, etc. In other words, people form self-interest groups or factions for any number of reasons, some of them major, some of them seemingly insignificant. Think of the rivalry between high schools, for example, in football or basketball. Think of the number of people who go to those schools and say, oh, we hate such. Last night, for example, the Red Sox knocked out the Yankees 4-3 and won the best 3 out of 5 and knocked the Yankees out of a shot at the pennant or at a shot at the World Series. What's the first thing that Brett Gardner of the Yankees said after it was over? We hate to lose, but we hate to lose especially to those guys. We hate them, and they hate us. And they got a good team, and we dropped the ball. So the fact of the matter is, in terms of how it's going to impact our lives, whether the Red Sox are in it or whether the Yankees are in it doesn't matter. But to them, it's everything. And the fans are the same. So the fact of the matter is, Madison says, people divide over a number of different things. In Republican government, he says, the majority, however composed, ultimately give the law. In other words, our government as a republic is susceptible to majority rule. Whenever, therefore, an apparent interest or common passion unites a majority, what is to restrain them from unjust violations of the rights and interests of the majority and the minority or of individuals? If government is susceptible to majority rule, and that's really what Republican government is about, then the minute a common passion brings the majority together, the rights of the minority are in jeopardy. So of all the things that cause factions, creditors or debtors, rich or poor, that's your majority. The poor, the debtors, that's the majority you got to find a way to protect. You got a way to find a way to prevent. Madison says the great desideratum, in other words, the great balancer, the great equalizer in government, is such a modification of the sovereignty as will render it sufficiently neutral between the different interests and factions to control one party of the society from invading the rights of another, and at the same time sufficiently controlled itself from setting up an interest adverse to that of the whole society. Government's principal job is to balance the interests against each other so that no one interest can get power. Because when it does, it's going to abuse the others. And if majority rule is the faction you're most worried about, then somehow You have to have a government that the majority can never get control of. That's what we're seeing now in the Confederation, Madison is saying. Majorities are getting control over state governments, and look what they're doing. They're bringing civilization itself down on its knees. We ain't going to make it unless something changes. Madison says, in absolute monarchies, the prince is sufficiently neutral towards his subjects, but frequently sacrifices their happiness to his own ambition or his avarice, his self-interest. In small republics, which is what the Articles of Confederation creates, in small republics, the sovereign will is sufficiently controlled from such a sacrifice of the entire society, but is not sufficiently neutral towards the parts composing it. And then there's this line. As a limited monarchy tempers the evils of an absolute one, so an extensive republic meliorates the administration of a small republic. What you got to do is take power out of the hands of the states and put it in the hands of the national government. Because once it's in the hands of the national government, you make majority rule impossible, or at least seemingly impossible. Because what we're seeing now under Donald Trump with his Twitters and the media and mass communications is that President Trump has developed an ability to take national power, which is never there before. That's why the Republic, as the founders created, as Madison envisioned it, is in jeopardy. Because the whole security of the system was based on the idea that the majority, the poor, could never get control. And then Madison said, an auxiliary desideratum, in other words, another thing that meliorates the Republican form is such a process of elections as will most certainly extract from the mass of society the purest and noblest characters which it contains, such as will at once feel most strongly the proper motives to pursue the end of their appointment and be most capable to devise the proper means of attaining it. In other words, what we have to do is have a system of regular elections, because those elections give us the ability to identify and elevate the right people. People who put the public interest ahead of their own private interest, ahead of their own ambition and self-interest. In that number two, then, Madison has pretty well outlined Federalist 10. Federalist 10 is merely a refined form of number two under this particular thing in the vices of the federal system. So Madison is explaining to his colleagues and his friends who'll be joining him in Philadelphia within a month, this is what's needed. This is how we're going to do it. And when we get together next month, this is what we're going to present to you. And no sooner does the convention meet than Governor Randolph distributes copies of the Virginia plan. And he makes the point, the articles are so weak, so bad, there's so many things wrong with them, that we can't amend it. I know that you guys were sent here by your state legislatures to revise the Articles of Confederation, but we're telling you that they can't be revised, that what we've got to do is scrap the whole thing and start all over again. And here's something we can start our conversations with. And then they pass a motion that all the debates will be held in secret. Nobody's allowed to take out of the hall the things that are said there. We got to make sure that everybody is free to say what they want to say and what they think without having to pay a price for it. In other words, the last thing we want in here while we debate this is the media. A number of delegates realize what's happened, and they boycott. They flee the convention. They go home. Luther Martin stays for a while in Maryland, but eventually he begins to see what's happening, how this is a setup. This is a well-organized coup to weaken the power of the states at the expense of the central government. Luther Martin leaves the convention, goes back to Maryland, and begins to organize, publish, telling people what's going on in that convention. Basically, what he's doing is preparing the citizens of Maryland for the document that's going to come out of that convention. And he's telling them, this is what they're trying to do. This is how it's going to hurt us. When we see it, we got to vote it down. And that happens in a number of other places. So the question I ask, Madison, Hamilton, James Wilson, Benjamin Franklin, George Washington, John Adams, nationalists in every state, are these people villains? Are they manipulating the system and using PR to sell a system that the people don't even understand? Yes. Why? Because if people understood this, they never would ratify the Constitution. So ultimately, the Federalist Papers, which are the papers written to support ratification of the Constitution in the state of New York, are a highly sophisticated form of PR. They are propaganda. They are written from the point of view of the nationalists. They aren't an objective analysis of the pros and cons of the Constitution. They are efforts to relieve the fears of the people, counter the objections of the anti-federalists, and get this document approved. The last speaker on September 17th, the day that the convention adjourns and the delegates go back to their home state to try to promote the Constitution and get it approved in their own states, Benjamin Franklin, who's in his 80s, gets up before the convention and appeals to them. Franklin says, every one of us would make changes in this document. There are things in it that none of us like. But when you go back to your states, you gotta play this as if this was the best system of government ever created by the mind of man. You have to put aside your differences. There's a provision in there to amend it. If something doesn't work, we'll fix it. But Franklin says, if we don't get this adopted, we're dead. This society's going under. Law and order, rule of law, individual responsibility, all of those things are gone. So Franklin says, whatever you do, put aside your objections to it and sell it. Because it's the Union or disaster. Those are the choices. And that's the context within which the Constitution of the United States is drafted and ultimately ratified by the requisite number of states to become the law of the land and the fundamental law, statement of fundamental law of this nation. It seems to me that you can't understand the Constitution unless you know some of this background. You don't have to know it all, obviously. But you got to know why the Constitution is written the way it is written, what it was intended to accomplish, what it was intended to fix. Madison lays that out in this Vices document. He tells us from his perspective what's wrong with the Articles of Confederation and what this convention that's coming up next month has to repair. And he prepares his colleagues, his friends, for the fact that we got a job on our hands. We're going to have to move this baby through this convention. One of the things that they force them, find themselves that they have to do, is keep the South there. Because Southern delegates are going to realize that if we lose state power to a strong central government, we're jeopardizing slaves. We're endangering the future of slavery in this country. So what one of the things that the Southern states do is force the convention to make compromises to slavery in the Constitution. The Three-Fifths Compromise, all of those things are concessions in order to keep the Southern states on board. Because the most important thing are not the compromises you make, it's getting the document itself through. So all the compromises that our textbooks emphasize, it seems to me the key issue to understand the Constitutional Convention are not the details of the conferences, but what is it that makes compromise possible? In other words, if these delegates are able over and over again to prevent a mass walkout at the convention by making compromises, by negotiating the differences, then there must be something bigger that they all want. If you're going to compromise, there's got to be a reason. And the reason is the future of the country itself. And so that raises the question. Are these guys heroes? Or are they villains? A couple of years ago, in a piece that I wrote up in the Charleston Gazette here in West Virginia, this was written in March of 2015, I talked about how difficult it is to teach this kind of stuff in our classrooms. We continue to teach blacks and whites. We dodge the grays. This is a gray, and this is the quote that I wrote to introduce this article. Quote, "It's not when the results are predictable that good teaching matters. It's when the lines between good and bad become fuzzy, when fine points need refinement, when nuances need clarification, when what's right seems not to be winning, when students search in vain for right answers, that's when teachers can and must really teach." In other words, we've got to stop dodging these controversial subjects and deal with them. And by dealing with them, you're giving the students the skills they need to deal with them themselves. You don't tell students to memorize the fact that the Articles of Confederation was a critical period, that the nation was going down the tubes without the Constitution. What you do is you explain what's wrong with the Articles of Confederation. You make clear what the Constitution does to fix those things that are wrong. And you leave it to them to realize the serious challenges that face this nation and what the founders had to do to meet them. Personally, I believe they're heroes. I believe, given the challenges, the problems that they faced, it was a miracle what they were able to achieve. Granted, they had to pull a few fast ones to get it. But because they had to pull a few fast ones, does that mean the Constitution itself ought not to have been ratified when the alternative was disaster? No. Our whole constitutional system is based on compromise. It's based on the realization that in order to do it and make it together, we've got to constantly discuss our differences and fix them. That's what's wrong now with this tribalism that's emerged in our two-party system. That's what's wrong with Trumpism. Government is not emphasizing the things necessary to bring us together. Government is promoting the things that divide us even further. It deals with matters of race. It deals with issues of misogyny, the abuse of women. It deals with disengaging ourselves from the world that we've been leading since World War II and jeopardizing the worldwide system of prosperity that we were able to help achieve. All of this is on the table. It seems to me that in order to work, this system that Madison and his colleagues created demands compromise, demands the ability to meet together and resolve our differences together, because the result will be the greater good for everybody. And Trumpism is destroying that. That's why I think it's such a threat. That's why I think this year's midterm elections are so critical. That's why I think Democrats have to start addressing the issues, not just attacking Trump, but pointing out what they stand for and what they'll do if they win. It's got to be a hell of a lot more than trying to impeach the president. The more you do that, the more you drive the people who aren't sure into Trump's camp. What you have to do is deal with people's problems, people's issues. And what you have to do is support an agenda that will address those issues. All of that in less than a month. It's going to be interesting, I think. Well, that about does it. We've reached the top of the hour. It's just 3 p.m. in the East. I want to thank you for being with us today, being with us for this entire week. And if everything goes well, we'll be back together again on Monday. The Vices document is on the webpage, is on the Facebook page, the Virtual Center Facebook page. I do invite you to take a look at it. We went through it kind of fast. But I think the kind of perspective that I tried to develop today will bring new meaning to the Constitution, will bring new meaning to what Madison is saying about the problems and the challenges of the Confederation. For Agnes and Bob Kincaid and the folks at Head On Radio Network, and for me, Bill O'Brien, thank you so very much. Batten down your hatches, because it's going to be a tough 24 to 36 hours for many of us. I hope you have a wonderful rest of the day, a wonderful rest of the week and weekend. And if everything comes out well, we'll be back together again next Monday. Thank you so very, very much. I hope that you enjoyed this material as much as I enjoyed bringing it to you. Thank you.